services. We're praising the mighty Yah.
Hallelujah.
Can I call on none other than the two lions, the three young lions of Yehuda? And they would like to come forth at this time so they can praise the mighty Yah. Come on, my young lions. They gotta perform a soundtrack off of their album. My brother, Azariah, being Israel. This is his two sons.
Right after that, oh.
This is the song of the sinner. Cleanse me from iniquity. Please wash me from my sins, oh God. Have mercy on my soul. I pray that you take away this emptiness in my bones. Only to you, oh God. We don't deserve you, but we're going to serve you and keep our lives. And I say,
Yah is your heart, Yah is your heart, Yah is your heart, and come on, Yah is your heart, Yah is your heart, make sure you think he's praying your way. Yah-Yah-Hot, everybody stand up now. Yah-Yah-Hot, Yah-Yah-Hot, Yah-Yah-Hot. I can hear you, everybody stand up now.
Hey.
This is what we're gonna do. Stand up now. Stand up for the second time, cause I'm gonna say that this is the only day, the only day. And be able to talk to people that know the mighty Yah by way of the internet. There's very few people out here in this world that know who the true and living Elohim is. So, greatly appreciative to be amongst so highly intellectual people who knows where their help comes from.
Yes, sir.
Who that knows where their protection comes from.
Yes,
and who knows and who hand they belong.
Hallelujah.
So praise Yah.
Hallelujah.
And once again, those that are visiting by way of the internet audience, if you tune in for the very first time to the house of Yehuda, my name is Joel Israel. I'm one of the ministers here, along with Michael Israel, who talked earlier in our Sabbath services at 1 p.m. And now we're going to resume our Sabbath services with the head minister here at the house of Yehuda. And I'm speaking none other than Moray Zikiar Ben Israel, who studied under the late servant of Yah, Moray Elisha Israel, for over 20 years, and also Moray Daniel Israel as well. He is a dedicated servant of Yah, and I'm honored to call him forth, and he likewise, and all the ministers here will answer your questions or concerns that you might have regarding our subject matter. And I'm honored to call him up, and I'm going to do that at this time. If we all rise and welcome another great servant of Yah, Moray Zikiar Israel, by saying hallelujah.
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 Praise the mighty Yah.
Yah is righteous
all the time.
Oh, thank you. And thank you, the internet audience, for tuning in to the afternoon services. And those that can't make it to the services during the morning or can't make it to the Knesset in Cincinnati, Ohio, thank you for at least tuning in to the internet. And before we say our prayer, let's give honor and praise to the mighty Yah, the creator of the heavens, the earth, the seas, and all that therein is by saying hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's turn our scriptures to Psalm 64. We're going to write and recite this great psalm together. Psalm 64. Hear my voice, O Elohim, in my prayer. Preserve my life from fear of the enemies. Hide me from the secret counsel of the wicked, from the insurrection of workers of iniquity, who let their tongue like sword, and bend their bows to shoot their arrows, even bitter words, that they may shoot in secret at their workers. Suddenly you may shoot at them, and fear not. They encourage themselves in evil matter. They commune of the land's affairs privately. They say, who shall see them? They search out iniquities. They have accomplished a diligent search, for the inward thought of every one of them, and their heart is deep. But Elohim shall shoot at them with arrow. Suddenly shall they be wounded. So they shall make their own tongue to fall upon themselves. All that see him shall flee away, and all men shall fear, and shall declare the work of Elohim, for they shall wisely consider their own doing. The righteous shall be glad in Yahweh, and shall trust in him, and all the upright hearts shall glory.
Hallelujah!
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 Hallelujah! Praise the mighty God! Yah is righteous all the time.
Any comments on this great song? Yes, sir, El.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We're going to the front end and the back end. Let's take verse 1.
Yes, sir.
Hear my voice, O Elohim, in my prayer. Preserve my life from fear of the enemy. When we have a personal relationship with our Creator, whose name is Yah, and we pray to Him daily, but not only pray, but walk the walk that we should be walking. In other words, doing our best to keep the law, the statutes, the judgments that the Almighty gives us, showing mercy and doing all those things that we should do, then our hope is that the Almighty hear our prayer and be our help. Because if we're not doing any of the above, how can we expect the Almighty to be there for us? Because there's a little word in the scriptures that we all should be aware of, and it's if. See, we have people that talk about unconditional love. As far as I know, there's no such thing
right. As
unconditional love. I love you unconditional. As soon as you get this axe out my back, I'm still gonna love you. So there's no such thing. And then we'll skip down to verse 10. It said, the righteous shall be glad in Yahweh and shall trust in him, and all the upright in heart shall glory. That's pretty much self-explanatory itself. Because when you're righteous and you're doing the things that you should do, I'm quite sure not only would an individual have a testimony, but they have tons of testimony giving glory to the Almighty Yah for the things he's done for us. And that comes from being that upright person, being that righteous person, walking in integrity, walking in the law. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sister
Hila. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I agree with Brother Hume. I was going to comment on verse 10 too, because Yahweh, He is all encompassing in our life. He's on everything. Everything that we do revolves around Him, and He's right at the center. And when you compare that to people who center their lives as vanity, or pursuits of vanity, you just can't help but feel sorry for them, because at the end of it, it's not going to be that glory that it talks about here, and about the heart of the upright. So, you know, I just thank Yah that He has allowed us to have a privilege, because it's so many people I talk to. And I, you know, and my heart, I be in tears sometimes when somebody can't just see it, and I'm showing them the scripture, they just can't get it. They can't understand it. You know, and it's like Yahweh have to let that person hear this. Because like that scripture says in Isaiah 29, it's like a book that's sealed. They just can't understand it. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I just really thank God, truly with all of me, that he have allowed us to have this privilege to be in his presence. Ooh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Any other comments on this website? Yes, my sister. And then Elder.
Yes, it is. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It is a great privilege and an honor to open up, to have your life open up to all that's been opened up to you once your eyes have been opened.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a knowledge of what's being taught to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a wisdom, and it fills you up.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a joy, you know, it just fills you up so much, and it's just an unspeakable joy.
Mm-hmm.
It just makes you love the words. It just fills you up so much, you just can't explain it. And when people don't get it, you just can't get that they don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so self-explanatory. You know, you just throw your hands up in the air.
Mm-hmm.
And walk away.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a great blessing, and we really don't realize how much of a blessing it is.
Yeah.
When you're on the outside, until the Almighty actually opens up your eyes to see. And we put a little bit too much on people, because everybody's not going to see it until the Almighty opens up their eyes. See? We're the blessed ones. And remember, the scripture says only there'll be a remnant.
Right.
And a remnant is any small number of the whole.
Right.
See, we keep thinking that, or keep wanting, and it's good that we desire as many of our brothers and sisters as possible to have their eyes open, heart open to the ways of the Most High, and adapt to them, not just have the eyes and heart open. But Yah has his ways of doing things, and he has his number that he selected. And majority of the people, sorry to say, is not going to be a part of that number. And just because our eyes have been opened, it does not necessarily mean that we are going to be a part of that number. Because we have to put in work. See, we just can't be educated. We have to put in work. So if you don't put in work, then you're going to fall short. Yes, Elder Kim.
I give our glory, our honor to the Holy One of Israel, whose name alone is Yahweh. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Number two, hide me from the secret counsels of the wicked, from the insurrection of the workers of iniquity. And what I get on that one is, you know, I appreciate Yahweh, you know, hovering over me, hide me from the secret, you know, counsels, hide mm-hmm. me, you know, from the wicked with his laws, you know, with his commandments, mm-hmm. you know, when just, you know, being able, you know, to decipher, you know, wicked, mm-hmm. you know, and stand up for righteousness, you know, and, you know, being hidden, you know, not just, you know, like, just, you know, just out of, you know, just out of the picture, you know, just knowing that, you know, you are governed and counseled by his laws, you know, and you, you know, and then, you know, you're, that you are, you know, not, might not be amongst the wicked, but, you know, you are hidden, you know, you're hidden with something, you know,
mm-hmm.
he gives you a shield, you know, he gives you his laws, he gives you his commandments, his statutes, you know, that's what you're hidden, you know, behind, you know, the way I feel about mm-hmm. that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Are there any other comments on this great song? Verse number 3. Any comments on that one? What do we learn from that verse? It says, which is the continuation of verse number 2. And we start back in number 2 where it says, hide me from the secret counsel of the wicked, from the insurrection of the workers of iniquity, who whet their tongue like a sword, and bend their bows to shoot their arrows, even bitter words. So when we look at that, what does that tell us? Does this remind us of what we used to be at? Or maybe, hopefully not, where we're at now? I'll come back to you, El. Yes, Sister Don.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Those 3 verses remind me of something that I see. I guess it's kind of a general human tendency for people to be around other people who are like-minded and then become cliquish.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, it may start out with good intentions, but because they all may feel a particular way about a certain subject, it ends up being like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really horrible.
Yes, it is.
When a bunch of people get together, I mean, there's a lot of good that you can do with that, but they'd rather do something evil and malicious and tear down other people with that.
Mm-hmm.
And you really, you don't need to put your energy there. Think
positive. Hallelujah. Because what they're saying there in there is a very negative thing. You know, you're gossiping, you're tearing down a person's character, or you're putting inflammatory words out there that may damage a person's character, may prevent it from a lot of different things. You know, from advancing it, make advancements on the job, it could affect a person in many different ways. Break up homes, it could do many, many different things that is wicked, you know. And we as a nation of people is very guilty of that. Even learned men and women are guilty of that. Not just those that don't know. Sister Shamir?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, verse 2, 3, and 4 reminds me of what's going on today with our people, how we've been just like wiped out by the Gentile police officers and, you know, things like that. And then the words, the reason for it, they try to justify killing us off, like we just flies flying around their house and, you know, aggravating them. And they're killing us, you know, innocent people, our people, innocent people, you know. And it just reminds me of that.
Hallelujah. Any other comments on this great song? All right, if there's no other comments, let's move on to current events. Are there any current events that you would like to bring forth to class today? Elder?
All praise to the Creator.
This next best thing
they're talking about that they're advertising now about this watch,
mm-hmm.
that you can buy now, I think right. they go anywhere from $500 to $2,000
right.
something
right.
like that. It was on a program yesterday I was watching on Al Jazeera.
That Apple Watch?
Yes. About all the things that it can do. But it didn't tell the people the other things that it can do. Like monitor your heart,
mm-hmm.
tell people where you are, tell them what you're doing. All it is something that's giving them all the information they need about you 24 hours a day.
Yes, sir.
And you're unbeknownst to it.
Yes, sir. And, you know, these are the dangers, which this man will never tell you all that he has planned and everything that's involved with his plans, including your technology. He's never going to tell you that. This man has been spying on people for decades. You know, for decades. If it's not through watches, which that's the latest of technology, but through your TV, through your refrigerators. I mean, he has been diabolical for ages. And the thing about it, how people don't even question it.
And they're standing in line for
it. Yes, they're running, can't wait to get to it. You know, and in some cases, may hey, go to war with you if you buy the last one. Or if you permit them to get up there and spend your hard-earned money on these things. You know, what kind of gimmicks do you need a refrigerator or freezer to do just to keep your food cool? You don't need all of that. Just like the watch. What do you need all of that for just to tell time? I mean, the Timex you buy for $15, $21 and you spend $500 or $600 up to $1,000+ for this watch that's telling the government everything about
you. Everything, yeah.
Everything. And things that you don't want to know. Don't want them to know. Elder?
Two things. One is population control. We talked about that often. And I was thinking, you know how we say when you go through the scriptures, it magnifies things even more to you? And I don't want to think that I'm the only one who may have considered this, but here's food for thought. Now when we watch TV or movies or whatnot, you see a lot of gay activity. It's just about everything that you watch. Even some cartoons that are supposed to be for children. And I think that's a way of trying to get people conditioned. But I think the end result is population control. Because remember, the world has an agenda. What is it, 6.5 billion or something? They won't take down the 2.5 billion. Mm-hmm. See, two women and two men can't populate. Plus, the end result for them is going to be death anyway. Anyway, so that's just, and then if you say something about it on your job or if you're in a certain profession or whatever, then you're blackballed because you're going against what they're trying to. For me, it seems like they're trying to make it mainstream, like it's perfectly natural or whatever. So that's just food for thought. With me, it reverts back to population control. Then there's another, I just want to introduce it, and then the elder here, he can go on. There were four black individuals, I believe in New York, is it? In New York. Now, four black individuals in the vehicle get pulled over by four white cops. Now, think about this. And these four individuals that were pulled over know that they were profiled because they were black. But it turns out that they were officers, their parole officers, going to execute a warrant. And not only were they pulled over, they were pulled over and were brought out of their car at gunpoint. Now, they didn't know this when they pulled them over. They didn't know this at all. So, again, when we were talking about having a personal relationship with our Creator and the importance of prayer and building that relationship with the Almighty keeps you, even if you find yourself in a situation like that, prayerfully the Almighty preserves you. But when you don't have a relationship with the Almighty, you just walk against His laws, it can be really bad. Really bad, but the elder here has more information on that.
Okay, now, the four parole officers, they were wearing bulletproof vests. They had their shields on their neck, displaying that they were law enforcement officers. Plus, they wasn't given the opportunity to show their official state ID. And they held them at gunpoint for well over an hour. And so let me read just a little bit of this. This happened at Rockland. New York. Parole Officer Mario Alexander said one of the police officers recognized him, yet the detainment continued. The incident ended with no arrest or charges. Alexander called the car stop an attack on my life and integrity. The Ramapo Police Lieutenant Robert Lancia, Captain Thomas Copley, Sergeant Margaret Samaroni, and Surface Sergeant Edward Dolan were identified as being among the officers involved in the incident. Now, these are high-ranking officers on that police force. We all know what's going on with that situation.
Well, it doesn't make any difference, you know, whether it's just a rookie or a lieutenant or a sergeant or captain or whatever. They do the same. And we're not talking about all police officers, but those that are bad, those that are stinking, those that are showing the behind, exposing themselves. You know, they do the same thing. And it's in their nature. It's the way that they have been grown or nurtured to do, to enforce their so-called law. It's not about keeping a citizen safe. It's about authority. Now, anybody, whether they knew the officers or not, if they saw a bunch of guys, four or five of them, that had ID, vest, and especially if you knew one of them was a officer, then hey, you know, why would you even go through that? They go through it because they can. Because they can. That's the only reason. Because they can. And if something happens, they can get away with it. Have been doing it for ages. There was a black lieutenant who was mic'd up with the mic and camera, who was doing an experiment in L.A. He was thrown through a plate glass window by police. Police in New York and in L.A. will tell you firsthand. Black police will. Hey, when they get off duty, they're afraid just like you and I would be. Mm. The color's blue, mm-hmm. Not black and blue, blue. Yeah. And the blue represents the white establishment. Mm-hmm. Sister Eve.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I wanted to comment on the news media.
Yes, ma'am.
They, I've been watching this week really in disgust because they have really started to jump, you know, I guess playing up the polarity between the prosecutor and the officers.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
Baltimore.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And so, you know, more and more, it really disgusts me how the media has really sided, and they have gotten the people to believe that, you know, how dare she charge these officers?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they really have become, you know, so gatekeeperish, even though they always have been, but it just wasn't as obvious as it is now. You know, a lot of people are expecting for the charges to somehow be dismissed because of the way that they have tried this case in the media. So, you know, saying that they were going to start looking into her background and, you know, seeing what's there. And I just, you know, I mean, it, to me, it's just, it's terrible. How do you seem to feel a crime wasn't committed, you know, the media could constantly refers to Mr. Freddie Gray as injuring himself, mm-hmm. you know, refusing to acknowledge that an injury occurred at the police officer's, you know, arrest. And mm-hmm. so, to me, I just find that disgusting for them to continue to put the spotlight on her and, you know, try to play up to whatever potential jurors may be out there to make them to not see things the way that they truly are. And just, to me, that just is awful.
Well, she's probably getting received numerous death threats by now, threats of a job. Mm-hmm. Like I said, you know, when she first took out the warrants and against them, that her life was going to be hell until after this was over with. And she could probably forget about being a DA in Massachusetts, or Maryland rather, because, hey, the whole state of Maryland is aware of the incident. You got 31 people that have died in Baltimore City alone at the hands of the police. 100 in Maryland at the hands of the police. And all and 70% of all of them that died or was murdered were black. Black lives does not matter. And not only there in Baltimore, but we heard of the incident with the Beta Israel in the state of Israel. They rioted, or I don't like to use that term, they had an uprising during the same week as Baltimore did for the same purpose, same reason. Black men getting beat by the police. And even one of them was a military officer. And they beat him. They beat him. Mm-hmm. And of course the people said, we're not gonna stand for this. And they did some things that any other person that's oppressed would do. So it's not just Baltimore. It's not just LA. It's not just wherever. It's global. Because if you're a descendant of Israel, you're going to go through that hell. See how people don't even realize it. They still talk about marching. Mm-hmm. They still talk about young people getting together, old people getting together. They work out their differences and they try to bring forth a workable solution. The only workable solution is get on your knees and start praying to the Most High. Ask him to forgive you for all this idol worshiping and everything that you have been doing and going to be doing for the rest of your life unless you have a heart of change. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing to say. How can a civilized man think that he can serve an idol of wood, stone, metal, and expect to be treated like a human being? When there's only one true Elohim? They know something. Your enemies know something that they don't know. They know when you don't have the protection of the Most High with you. They can do anything to you that they want to. Why do they think all of this is going on? It's not by chance. Seeing these pig feet, chitlin eating ministers, still going along with the same thing. Collecting the money on the first day and sending them out there in the hellhole, not teaching them anything about the Most High. Nothing. So yes, this is going on not just here, but over in the state of Israel. And who is Israel a puppet of? United States. United States. So should anyone be surprised? They even, I don't know whether it was a law or whether it was just a group of business people that got together and said they would not sell to the black Ethiopians any property or not even rent them a house or an apartment.
Sounds like the United States, don't it? If it didn't put Israel in there, it would think it was right here in the United States. Because they still red line and still refuse to rent to black people whenever they choose to. And always cunning and wise enough to go and circumvent the laws of discrimination in order to bring that into effect. Yes, my sister.
And also, speaking of them, I saw them in the news. The Ashkenazi Jews over there in the land are having a civil war against the Ethiopian Jews, and it's been a slaughter going on. And I just noticed they've been talking about it recently in the news. Usually they don't say a word.
That's right.
But this week I did hear them mention it. You know, so I don't know how they can reconcile the way they have been over there saying some of the most racist rants. You know, they don't come across on the news, but you can see them on Facebook.
Right. And
they always expose them.
Yeah.
And, you know, calling them all kind of N-words.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you said they refused to rent them property, that was also the Palestinians.
Mm-hmm.
They was refusing to sell any of these Ashkenazis any property or rent to them. If anybody was caught renting to them or selling them anything, they would be ostracized for that. So for them to turn around and do this to the Ethiopian Jews who have been on the run as a refugee for some reason over in that area. I don't know if they're running from Boko Haram or if they're running from some other jihad militia, but they somehow enter into the borders of the Israelis, and they have been viciously attacked. The attacks have been very brutal, killing them. It looked like, when I saw it on the news, it looked like something out of what we just had in Ferguson or what Baltimore. It looked like, I'm like, what is that here? No, that's there.
Yeah.
You know, I really was surprised to see, you know, it looks exactly the same.
Yeah. With Mossad exposing the wickedness of the state of Israel to the whole world. You know, this is a country that escaped their native lands of Poland, Germany, and so forth, and had the backing of the U.S. to go in and take other people's property. But yet, the true recipients or owners of the property, now they're doing to them what they were complaining to the world about has been done to them. But the Most High, he's in control, and he's exposing their nakedness to everybody, to the whole world. And the thing about it is that it's going to get worse. See, it's not going to get any better. It's going to get worse. But you got a people that continue to transgress against the Most High. We're talking about right here in America now. The Israel that's in America, whether we're from the tribe of Yehuda, or from the tribe of Benjamin, or whatever. Our nation as a whole still hate the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
How do we hate the Most High? Well, reads Exodus 20. And the Most High tells, as though he tells us throughout the whole scriptures, those that refuse to keep his laws and do his commandments, they hate him.
Mm-hmm.
Period. So it doesn't take a Solomon to figure out how you can tell if somebody hates the Most High or not. It doesn't take a Solomon. See, they like to say Einstein, but Einstein was a midget.
Mm-hmm.
Had a midget brain compared to Solomon.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all you have to do, is look and see. What is his relationship with the Most High? If he thinks the Most High is that
thing they call JC and the Holy Ghost and all these other kind of ghosts, then hey, he's a bigger fool than what they have labeled imbeciles to be. Because you know they label you by your quote unquote IQ level. They got a level, I think, below 50 or imbecile or something of that nature. And in order to be a genius or near genius, like they say Obama is, y'all, you have to be is over 160, 170, 180 in that range. So, you know, these are the folks that don't adhere to the Most High and don't adapt to Him. It's their IQ is off the charts, and I'm not talking about up here, I'm talking about down here. Because they have no intelligence. They have none. Just the elder than the other Moshe.
Here's another about the Holy Flute. And so far, it states that since March, the virus has led to the loss of well over 30 million birds in 13 states. And then it says, follow on, it says 4 million birds will be euthanized. And our chicken loss will approach 25 million. More than 40% of the state's egg laying flock. Then it talks about the turkeys too. Then it says state officials on Friday also announced detection of the virus on five more turkey farms. But only provided a number for one farm. 42,000 birds. That raises the turkey losses an hour to more than 750,000 birds.
Wait a minute, let me stop you right there. You said that the virus has been spotted on how many other new farms or how many other farms, but only to register the numbers for one farm?
They only, according to this report, they only listed the numbers for the turkeys. From only one farm.
From one farm. So, who all eats turkey? Okay, mostly everybody in here. So what does it tell you? See the diabolic nature that these folks have? What are they going to do with those other turkeys? That they're not numbering and putting them in the system as being unclean.
Right.
They're going to ship them off to their little dispensaries. They sell the turkeys, either give them away, and you'll never know that you're eating something with listeria in it, bird flu in it, or anything of that nature. Those that they can't sell, they will give them away. They will give, that's right, free store, food banks, in other communities, et cetera, et cetera. But there's a purpose. You know, they don't do anything without a purpose. How many people may get sick and may die? You go back to controlling the population. There's many avenues that they can put into effect to do this. And the ones that's going to affect the most is our people. Children will be getting sick. Elders will be getting sick. Because those are the weakest of the population. So, you know, it behooves us to always investigate and check out things, and for you, you know, have the knowledge that, hey, this stuff may not be kosher, leave it alone. Leave it alone.
Or be careful where you buy your food.
That's right, and the safe way to buy your food if you're not growing it on your own is check out the organic places. And only buy from them if you're sure, if you've been dealing with them for a while. You know, and I'm like, for a while, I'm talking about a consistently for some years. Because everybody is out for the money. And they will tell you anything to make a sale. That's why it's so important for us to get back to the old past, as the scriptures say. Then you know what you've got. Elder Moshe?
Yeah, I wanted to say a little bit about what the sister was saying about what's going on over in most of that rioting is going on with the Ethiopian Jews is happening in Jerusalem. And while they're being so terrible to the Ethiopians, they're forcing birth control on the Ethiopian women.
I was getting ready to bring that up, that's right.
Yeah, they're forcing birth control on the women so that they can't repopulate.
Mm-hmm. And they've been doing it for some years, over 3, 5, maybe 10 years. Mm-hmm. They have been feeding them this, I forgot the name of it, the technical name of it, but they have been feeding our women, or their women, this birth control, even though it could be dangerous to some of them, you know, through their lives. But they have been doing this, and it's just been exposed. And so that brings it back to right here in this country. Vaccinations, you see how they tried to push the vaccination off, and even doctors having the right to not even treat you if you don't take a vaccination, if you haven't had a vaccination. So it all comes to the fact of, hey, you know, we gotta get rid of some of these ends any way possible. Any way possible. Yes, sir.
Pleasure, y'all.
Hallelujah.
In Texas, they in a small town, and Cargo said, you know, go down there and practice martial law. Mm-hmm. And people they're concerned that they don't keep martial law down in the town. They said, the army said, we just practice martial law. Mm-hmm. They get all the right kind of area where they can. People try to get out and all that. I say, right there, it's showing the world right now, look, it's coming to America. It's coming. They try to practice down here in Texas right now.
Yeah, they just don't practice anything.
Right. Mm-hmm.
When they practice something, it's for a purpose.
It's a purpose. Mm-hmm.
And they know, you know, hey, we got things in place, and then we just have to practice our maneuvers. More remarks?
Oh,
no,
sorry.
Thank you. Okay. Yes,
Master
Sister
Donna. All
praises
be to Yahweh.
Hallelujah.
Earlier in the week, it was around the storms. It was 50 tornadoes in Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And on the news, they were showing it. There were hailstones so big, it was breaking people's windshields as they came down. And the only thing that you can say when you look at something like that is praise Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Like they even had the zoos busted open. They had wildlife walking around. Now, irregardless of what kind of training you have, who in here can fight off a lion? I mean, I'm just saying, if a lion is wandering around or a wildebeest or whatever they had in the zoo. They reported on the news that they got them all, but I mean, seriously. Just think about that in a large perspective.
Yeah.
Yahweh did that in one place. What if he decides to unleash that in, I mean, just about every major city has zoos. Then it would really be like Jurassic Park or something. You gotta outrun, not only the white people just have to get you, but you gotta outrun Yahweh's creation too. And it just made me just look at the bigger picture, like praise Yahweh for me knowing who he is. Even if I should not know who he is, I can instill that in my youth.
That's
and
right.
Whoever else I come in contact with, to where they might have some sort of protection in a day like that, because they may not have any other recourse other than their faith and their trust in Yahweh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Does anyone know of a time when there's ever been a famine in the United States?
Did you say back in the third
world? A famine.
The United.
Yeah, but it was in the 30s, from 31 to 32. Only they called it what?
Depression.
A depression. But during that particular time, they had 5 million farmers 5 million farmers that lost their land. And the government didn't give them any assistance at all. And of course, you know, during the so-called depression, there was lack of food. There was lack of jobs. People committed suicide. I mean, it's a horrendous situation. And it was the famine of the United States. Right now, you've got 17 and a half million people that are insufficient when it comes to their ability to buy food or having food on hand enough to feed their families. 17 and a half million. You have half of the West Coast that's under a drought situation. See? And you know, when we read our scriptures, sometimes we just read through it. But we have to read it and digest it to actually see what it means and what's going on. Let's turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. So when we talk about food shortage in the form of famine, the ability, don't have the ability to grow food because of the drought. Then you have a dire situation. And what does Ecclesiastes chapter 3 say? I haven't turned there yet, but does anyone want to read?
Everything there is a seat.
You start at the, let's see, course. You start at the 13th verse.
And also, that every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of Elohim. I know that whatsoever Elohim doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. And Elohim doeth it, that men should fear before him.
That's right. And that's one thing we still not doing. Still are not doing. It's fearing Yah. Because if we fear Yah, every Shabbat day, you couldn't even find an Israelite out on the street.
That's right.
Doing Shabbat time. That's right. But we don't fear Yah as a nation of people. We go and come and do our own pleasure, no matter how many times the Moray teaches that you should observe the Shabbat day. Mm-hmm. No matter how many times, we're still going to do our own thing. That's why it's only going to be a remnant. And what is the 15th verse, continuation of the 15th verse? It says, that which has been is now, and that which is to be has already been, and Elohim requireth that which is past.
Hallelujah.
Now we've got all the makings in this country right now of another famine. Drought, no rain. That's what is causing drought, but they're beginning to admit that, hey, you know, because of the climate change and so forth of that nature, which a few years ago they were saying there was no such thing.
Mm-hmm.
But now we got half of the West Coast in a serious drought. And Yah requires that which is past. When you look through the scriptures, one of the ways, there was three ways in particular that the Most High chastised his people. and the land that they lived on. One was through pestilence, one was through the sword, and the other was what? Famine. And right now, we've definitely been getting the sword harder, but it's not as bad as it's gonna get. See all our brothers and sisters that died and nobody's coming to the aid? You don't have any aid. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The Almighty God is your aid. Mm-hmm. Which our people, you know, maybe that don't know anything about Yah, is failing to realize when we tell them that. Mm-hmm. There's nobody that can come and deliver you out of your misery. Mm-hmm. Nobody. Mm-hmm. I don't care who they are, what police department it is, what mayor it is, what DA it is, where they live at in the United States or abroad, can deliver Israel out of its situation. Nobody. But see, we still keep running to these politicians. We still keep running to these chitlin-eating ministers. We still keep running to our enemy for help. And nobody can deliver us out of Yah's hands. So when we read that, we should take heed. When Yah says he requires that which is past, he's not just talking about yesterday. He's talking about for centuries. Because we hard-headed Israel, ungrateful Israel, disobedient Israel, cursed Israel, fail to hearken. And we can always justify the reason why we don't in our own heart or mind. Let's look at Amos chapter, excuse me, 8. Let's drop down to verse 11. What does it say here? Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh Elohim, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of Yahweh.
Hallelujah.
See, and we should never depend on someone else to motivate us to study the scriptures. Because when the Almighty brings his boom through, or the days of Jacob's trouble getting in full blast, you may not ever see Yoel, me, or Michael. No. You have to study for yourself, and you have to be motivated to study for yourself.
That's right.
Don't depend on any man to motivate you to study, because if you do, you won't be studying for long. And the Almighty said he's going to cut this off.
That's right.
We don't appreciate the sanctuaries anyway.
No.
We gather together on the Sabbath day when we want together. We call and do our own will on the Sabbath day. The Almighty said don't speak your words on the Sabbath day. We talk about people's dresses and pants and everything else on the Shabbat day. And that's in the Almighty sanctuary. This is amongst people who know the Most High.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or supposed to know the Most High. Mm-hmm. And that's not the only conversation that goes on. Mm-hmm. You say, don't bring burdens out on the Shabbat day. And we can't wait to get up with a burden to carry forth out on the Shabbat day. We are a people that don't hearken. Mm-hmm. And what did the Most High tell us say? It is, what did he tell Saul? Is obedience is better than what? Sacrifice? to get on our behinds about obeying. Because obedience takes precedent over talking. See, obedience is the number one thing that Israel can do to get back into graces of the Most High. Many of us think we got it made just because we attend the Shabbat day on a regular basis. Hey, you better check yourself and see. Just because you're in the sanctuary every Shabbat day don't mean that you got that, hey, the sacred number. What makes you a part of the remnant? This is something you have to work on all your life. We got brothers out here, 30-some years in the sanctuary, 30-some years in the sanctuary. They cannot tell you that they have a permanent spot with the Most High. Because what did he say? He's going to bring everything into what? Judgment. The good and the bad. So we've got some work to do. And have to keep teaching this all the time. All the time. Can't take a break. And the prophets had it much worse than we do. Much worse. Because those jokers be out there ready to kill them, ready to slay them for saying the same things that we're saying today. That's why the Almighty said, hey, don't be afraid of their faces. You want to tell them what I said. When we transgress against Israel, guess what? Well, that's why Yah moves our enemies against us. Because when we transgress against Him, see, we have committed the utmost transgression. When we transgressed against Him. I mean, when I first read in Exodus 20, where He said, hey, those that hate me, and all you have to do to show that you hate Yah is to disobey His commandments. And all you have to do to show that you love Him is to keep His commandments. See, that's not hidden. Let's look at Exodus 20. And we're going to start at the first verse. And Elohim spake all these words, saying, I am Yahweh thy Elohim, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other Elohims before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that was in the earth beneath, or that is in the earth or waters under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, Yahweh, the Elohim, am a jealous Elohim. Visit the iniquities of the fathers upon the children until the third, the fourth generation of them that do what? Hate me. So how do you show Yah that you hate Him? You refuse to keep any one of His commandments. Not just the Shabbat day, but any one of them. Sixth verse, and showing mercy to thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. So how do you show that you love Him? Keep His commandments. Simple, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it must be the most difficult thing in the world because Israel can't do it. Correct myself. Israel will do it. They're just too stiff-necked, hard-headed, rebellious to do it. Thou shalt not take the name of Yahweh the Elohim in vain, for Yahweh will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Remember the Shabbat day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of Yahweh the Elohim. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. And we talked a little bit about, hey, you know, what is working? Because if you don't understand it, work involves mental exertion as well as physical exertion, then hey, you can be in trouble. Mental activity as well as physical activity. Any comments before we move on? Yes, sister.
I want to comment on verse 7.
Yes, ma'am.
I was meditating on this morning before I came to class about how an evil thing it is for you to take Yahweh's name away. In my book, it reads this way. It says, you shall not take away the name of Yahweh, thy Elohim, to bring it to naught. Mm-hmm. For Yahweh will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name away to bring it to naught. And, you know, when we look at our scriptures and how his name is taken away into Lord and God, mm-hmm. and that is just the most wicked thing because Yahweh needs to get his credit. Mm-hmm. You know, that's right. We know how we feel about our name. We want our name out there in the fore on everything that we do. And for somebody to take his name off of his everything that he has been associated with, which is everything, you know, that is such a wicked deed. And it has been a stumbling block for our people, and it has been the gateway for these other gods to be worshipped, called Christ and the other deities. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I just was meditating on that this morning, you know, but he said his name will be sanctified and magnified, and they're going to have to know that he's Yahweh in the right. book of Ezekiel. But, you know, it's just, this is a commandment, mm-hmm. and it goes unchallenged, unnoticed. Nobody wants to ever consider this great commandment right here, number 7, you have taken his name away. Mm-hmm. And that's a commandment just like, you know, any other adultery, you know. And it was my meditation this morning.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
And it's a good thing that you meditate on that because it's very important. Mm-hmm. You know, once we learn Yahweh's name, never forget that name and never be afraid to use that name. See, because sometimes, you know, some of us get afraid of the faces, you know, when we get amongst our enemies. You know, all these Christians in here, you know, I want to get my point across, but, you know, I don't want to calling out Yah's name or anything of that nature. You know, in order to serve Yah, you have to be, like was said earlier, you have to be a man. You have to be a woman. You know, and this is something that we can't teach. You know, if you don't have it in your heart, then we can't teach you that. You know, you have to be jealous for the Elohim just like he's jealous for you. Mm-hmm. If you're not jealous for Elohim, you know, I can remember a time, and I don't want to, I'm not going to tell the whole situation, but it's one of the first conferences that we went to, but it was here right here in Cincinnati, and we had Morays from out of town and so forth, and even had a minister right here in town, and he made a comment about this book, y'all book ain't nothing. Mm-hmm. And I told Rich, I want to take his head.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's how much he excited me, the wrong way. But I did, I wanted to take his head. And I couldn't have anything to do with him after that, period. But Sister Don.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
No matter how many times I read or hear verses 5 and 6,
yes,
it scares me.
Because
I've seen Yahweh visit his iniquity, and I've also seen the child of Yahweh's mercy in a way that I just cannot find words. I can't wrap my brain around it.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it was only Yahweh that did that.
Yes.
So when I read it, it really just, gives me goosebumps.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, on 26, Exodus 26, I use that a lot with Christians. I have a friend whose brother was a pastor, and he had always taught that we needed JC because no man could keep the any of the commandments. And just last week, he called me up. Now, where's the scripture at where thousands have kept the Most High commandment? I said, it's Exodus 20, verse 6. Yeah, because you read it out your Bible, and y'all Israelites probably got different Bibles. I said, well, get your Bible out. And he read it. I said, is it in your Bible? Yeah. So, what do you got to say? I don't know. I have to think on this. I can't picture thousands of people keeping the commandment. That's what we need a JC for. And he's never got back with me on that. So I'm going to get back with you because there's got to be something more to it.
He won't.
He
won't. Because he's not going to admit that he was wrong. So, you know, he's not going to get back with me. Then go to his sister. Elder Kim.
Oh, Shalom. Hallelujah. It's funny, and Elder Russell is right. Because my sister, I hadn't seen her in a while, and when I seen her, she said, well, we need to get together, you know, we ain't got together in a while. I said, well, you know, I thought about that. I said, we're going to get together, I'm going to cook for everybody. So she said, when? So I said, well, what about, you know, the first day? And she was like, no, that's the day of rest. I was like, well, when that comes the day of rest, you know, I said, now I know what y'all, that's your book. My book, you know, and that's just, you know, I can, you know, relate to what he's saying. They always think we reading out of a different book. But you know what I mean, you older than me, you know this book better than I do. But I got it, we got a different book when it comes to when we say something. You know, when she say the day of rest, yeah, that's the day of rest. I was like, well, I didn't even get to get it out. That's what your book saying. What book? We don't have a book. Everybody got the same book. So when I say something, I'm reading out of a different book. It's just funny, you know, how they just, you know, they don't want to do it. So, you know, that's their reason, you know, for disobeying the Creator. You know what I mean? These are different books.
They really believe it.
They don't understand what we understand.
They've never have actually been taught.
Right.
They've never been taught. Only thing they've been doing, the elders, they're going to church ever since they was 5 or 6 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Never picked up the book to read for themselves. Never been told to read for themselves, you know, reading. Jack went up the hill and stuff in school, literally reading the whole scripture, you know, and that's all they've been taught to do. And it's foreign to them. So they actually do think that. Then, you know, once they find out, hey, let me, Lori Michael, then Elder Caleb, in Micah.
Praise Yahweh.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
As you was speaking when it comes to reverencing Yahweh, you know that mm-hmm. term was used before. Just reverencing Yahweh and acknowledging Him, that we've tried everything. Even going back as far as with that I'm dealing with Nat Turner, even his regime was stopped at one point. And then you have Marcus Garvey's Back to Africa movement. That was halted. He went as far as even to go get the boat to take us back home. That was halted. You got Black Wall Street, that was destroyed. You have the Black Power movement, which was infiltrated and destroyed. But they left a small legacy in the sense of what, well, not small legacy, but they did do some things for us. But none of those organizations, when I was reading up on them, ever glorified the Most High in them. Right. And the Almighty, as stated, is jealous. He said, I'm not going to share my glory with another. And before I allow you to get my glory, I will destroy you. And the things that this man did let us have that we fought so hard for was that civil rights movement. And I get a lot of people that disagree with me on this, but that's okay. The civil rights movement was one of the most destructive, most detrimental things to our people. And I say that because, now I wasn't raised up during that time, of course, so I understand about the uprising, and I can only comment on what I viewed or what I've studied on and read. But what I saw was, even though they showed the uprising and we getting attacked by dogs and just lynched, those things are still happening today, and the civil rights movement was put into effect. And what the civil rights movement did was it allowed me to be able to eat next to the master. The same one that spit in my food, I'm able now to eat next to him while he spits in my face. And you know, that was what it was, because we had a thing where we thought that the white man's water was better. We thought his food was hotter. We thought his bathrooms was cleaner.
His schools were better.
We thought his schools was better. But in actuality, we had it. And we had it, and all the money that we had, it was circulating our neighborhood. We had our own hotels where major stars would come and live. We had our own car lots. We had our own community. We were very communal people. But we had everything that was ours. But once that civil rights movement was allowed in after the death of Kennedy, and once all that was taken and brought in and allowed us to sit next to where it said colored only, now we can all walk through the front door. We can all walk through the front door but get treated with back door service. And that's what happened to us. It made us lazy. It made us complacent. It made us, and it showed something, how deep we are. It showed how we only wanted to be for ourselves when we were forced to. And unfortunately, that's what it's going to take for us to come together. It's by force. As long as we have a free will to whether eat at a black restaurant or a white restaurant, we ain't coming together. We ain't coming together. Why? Because that white entity is still there. It ain't just white people. We know that. But they're the ones that gave us. They're the ones that signed the papers to say, here's your, that it took this man to sign a paper to say that you got rights. You got rights now. No. And that should have, that whole civil rights movement should have showed us, and I'm a young man studying it, that we weren't brought here to be part of this democracy. We were brought here to work and to slave in this democracy. But what we want to do is I hear we need to march more. Through our history of our people and our plight, marching has never saved us. Because if it had, the first march that set foot in the United States for the rights of the people would have worked. But it didn't. If you have to constantly do the same thing, it's insanity. We're doing the same thing, expecting a different result.
Praise God. Just like you said, praise somebody, yeah. So many times, we were sitting here for punishment. See, we weren't sitting here to have a good life.
Right.
We were sitting here for punishment. To realize our mistakes, let the elders down, and for us to get right with the Most High Yah.
That's right.
That was the only reason. We weren't set here to drive Rolls Royces, to BMWs, or anything like that. We were set here as chastisement. And what Satan did, he interjected. He said, I'm going to bring you in up a little bit. I'm going to start paying you $5 an hour that you work at General Motors, and you can get you a decent car, and you're going to owe it all to me. And so we forgot about the Most High. We forgot to pray to Him, to thank Him. We start thanking our slave master, our enemy, and still do it today. If the Most High sent Moses back today, he's standing on the right side and a corporate president for any, you could choose any one of these corporations. Say, hey, you come to work for me on a Shabbat day, I got $100 an hour for you. Mm-hmm. Moses say, don't do that, it's death. Yeah, hey, I don't know whether you Moses or not, but I'm going to make this money.
Right.
That's our mentality. That's our sickness.
Mm-hmm.
But we want to sit here for all of that. And any upgrade that we have, hey, that comes from the Most High. For softening that man's heart, or your enemy's heart toward you. Like the Most High said, you know, those that bless Israel, I will bless. Those that curse Israel, I will curse. But how many times do we give praises to the Most High? Even when we give them praises, I'm talking about Israel as a whole, I'm not talking about the elect. They're not giving it to the Most High. They give it to that little blonde, buggy haired, you know, that's on the wall.
Yeah.
There. That's who they're giving it to. They're not giving it to the Most High. See? We place our confidence in wood and stone, the man, and all the other things that's supposed to be a man. We don't place it in the Most High. Just don't do it. And that's why we don't have the progress. The humans that a man is supposed to have. See, nobody has ever went to any governing body on behalf of Israel and say, hey, these are human rights that you need to give. If civil rights change all the dead on time, that's why they expire every so often.
Yeah,
no. Human rights last until the day that you die.
Yeah.
You don't hear anybody, the great civil rights leaders, we're going to march for this civil rights bill. We're going to try to get whoever's president in the office to sign this civil rights bill. We're going to try to do this. They won't even form human rights in their mouth. You hear a white man talk about human rights before he talk about before you hear a black man.
Yeah.
In fact, when they talk about going into other countries and interjecting their political ideas and their desires and so forth, and the people that's oppressed in another country, they don't go in with civil rights. They go in human rights.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. Human rights. But our people, you know, refuse to listen, refuse to hearken. If Israel, and I believe what Moray Dan used to say all the time, if Israel got themselves together as a nation, we could change history right now. Because Almighty already told us what to do. Already told us. Elder Caleb.
First and foremost, I want to give thanks to God by saying hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, the most powerful verse in here is number 3. Thou should not have no other Elohim before me.
Mm-hmm.
And we as a people has failed.
Sure. That's right.
In that regard. And then combine the fourth verse with the third verse, and thou shalt not make unto thee any graven idols or images. And what are you doing? Making those little crosses, having a picture of a white man on the wall is their God. And just totally turn that back on Yah.
That's right.
And earlier this week, I was over at Perryville on Walgreens, and there was a little sister out there. And she hit up and said, could you help me out there? I'm hungry. So I gave her a little money. And so I started asking her, did she know her identity? Did she know who Yahweh is? She didn't know he was one of them. So as I asked a few more questions, she couldn't give the answer to none of the questions that I asked. And then I asked myself, who is your Savior? And she said, Christ. I almost said, give me that money back.
Oh.
You know, that's the state of my people. And, you know, you could probably walk in a cornmeal.
Yep.
You could went right up to Clifton or any place else. And as long as one of our people, sister or brother, they gave you the same answer.
Yep.
Because they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know. I get back as soon as I get from Mike. Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was in reference to sister's question there. Most like he said that he give him eyes, but they're not seeing, ears and not hear. So basically, what you're dealing with is a person that has a contrite spirit. They're not going to get it. They're going to say you read a different book, different Sabbath day. And some people actually believe that Sunday is a Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. I understand. They think, like I talked to my that believe that Sunday was a Sabbath day. I said, did you look at your calendar? It's the first day of the week on the Julian calendar, on the Julius, the Gregorian calendar, of Pope Gregory, 1582. If you look at that calendar, you look at, if you go right to Webster Dictionary, which is a white man's dictionary, not no black, pro-black, none of that, no black militia, just a straight dictionary. Webster tells you that the first day of the week is Sunday, and the seventh day of the week is Saturday. So people don't know that their basic resources explain to them exactly what's going on.
Sure.
And if they don't take the time to do it. And they say that you don't follow the commandments, they nail to the cross. So I say, well, how can you say you don't follow the commandments when you can't even define a sin without the law? Because of sin is one of the transgression of the law.
That's
right. So like I gave her the same thing like I always do. If you got a speed limit, say 40 miles an hour, you go 45. I can't give you a ticket like that. A law to stipulate if you go over the speed, exceed the speed limit, what's the punishment, and what are the inequities, and what are the consequences for breaking these laws?
Mm-hmm.
So how can I say that I'm living by grace, and I don't know what a sin is?
Right.
The transgression of the law is the sin. So I can't even speak on the sin if I don't know what the law is.
Right.
And I'm also accepting tithes, which is a law as well. Why am I accepting tithes?
But they know that law. They know.
You know, like I said, it's just, but they got eyes not seeing, ears not hearing. That's basically what you're dealing with. It's not. And they mind, they believe that it's a different book. It's the commandments of men and tradition. And like you said, everybody's going to just hold on to Christ because that's the hip thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Like everybody got smartphones now because that's the hip thing to do. The flip phones are obsolete because the other phones are in style. You're going to go what's in style or you're going to get left behind.
Exactly.
That's just the way they go. So you got some people that defy that and just do what they're going to do. But that's what they mind. That they kind of in the trend. The trend sweater, not trend sweater. They go with the trend. So therefore, that's why their mind state is corrupted. And that contrite spirit, because if you don't have the spirit of Yah in you, then you can't begin to ever understand what's going on. It tells you in Ecclesiastes, he say, fear Allah, fear Yah, keep his commandments, the whole, here's the matter, the whole conclusion, I'm sorry, here's the conclusion of the whole matter, fear Yah, keep his commandments, it's the whole duty of a man or a woman.
Mm-hmm.
So that's it. If you can't keep the law and fear him and keep his commandments, real simple, like what you said
earlier. That's right.
And listen to the whole conclusion of the matter. Like you never listen to your whole conclusion. As soon as you guess, you start, they cut you off. They don't want to hear the truth because the truth will start to trickle down. So that's why they're not even letting you get it out. They're going to jump on you and attack you. And if there's four or five of them, you blaspheme, you, yeah, you right, I am blaspheming, I am antichrist, because I don't associate with that. His name, which is fictitious, Jesus Christ, so it doesn't equate to Jesus. Jesus doesn't equate nowhere in Hebrew at all. And it wasn't a J, it's not even a letter J in the Hebrew, the Latin, or the Greek. So where did the letter J come from? Also, his name, his face, his theology, where he came from. And if you look at the statue of him, he looked like the god Zeus. They put two headpieces together, they look like Zeus, the god. That's where you get Jesus from. So that's what I'm saying, is that the whole ideology behind it is false.
Mm-hmm.
The name, the image, and the idea of who he is. It's all false. So yeah, but I'm saying that's what they're dealing with. And that's where it comes from, just accepting a tradition. Your mother did it, it gotta be right. Mm-hmm. But that ain't the case. Your mother didn't have the right information, not the resource that you had. And with that information, you gotta utilize it. And understand, like I just said, so simple. It's in the book of John, it's in the New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
Sin is a transgression of the law. Biggest day. In that book. Mm-hmm. In the book of John, it's saying. So it's telling you that how can you even define a sin without the law? You can't even define it.
And
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I was blown by what you were saying about the right itself the king got killed.
Mm-hmm.
That's when the cry rightfully went out, was crazy. And but before that, to reveal and all that, we had our own everything. Like mm-hmm. we had our own hotel, everything, our own Harlem.
Yep.
Everything we had everything. I was saying, when I saw this to our chain came effect, see that thing so piece something lose everything. Everything I felt like Railroad and Gilbert, it was all black everything. We everything.
We get to depend on ourselves.
Yeah.
Right.
See, and that's where it's meant to be.
Mm-hmm.
That's what every nation does when it comes to this country. I used to deal with the Vietnamese, but the Koreans.
Mm-hmm.
They deal everything with their own people.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have black working in there doing anything, mm-hmm. unless it's, say, if it's beauty products, they're working on the floor. Mm-hmm. But they have no management positions, not dealing with any money or anything of that nature. All of this kept within their family. When they trade to order new products, guess where it comes from? If it doesn't come from Korea, it comes from another Korean shop, someplace in the United States. Every nation, they talk about the Mexicans. All of these nations that come in here, Koreans especially, because when I talk to one, everybody probably already knows the warehouse that they've got up there in the corner of Hamilton and North Bend. What she told me was that when she got there, there's a group of them that sponsored her, they gave her money to open up her shop. When she got financially able, she sent back to Korea and bring one back.
Mm-hmm.
And they all stayed mm-hmm. in the same apartment.
Mm-hmm.
And they put their little thing together. Now this one's got a shop, that one's got a shop. Send and bring another one in.
Mm-hmm.
We don't do that. We run from our own people and give our money to somebody else
mm-hmm.
so they can open up shops
yeah.
for their people.
Yeah.
Used to be a beauty, not a beauty, but a barbershop. Parker's used for years
right,
down in the West End
uh-huh.
on Lynn Street. He branched out, started dealing with supplies and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
Opened up a shop up on a supply center up on
Vernon.
I know he had one up on Gilbert Avenue too. The Koreans came in and took everything.
So did.
Took everything.
Mm-hmm.
So we are the people that hate ourselves. Not only do we hate ourselves, but we hate the Most High. So, you know, when we first got here and the Most High put us in this situation, as soon as we got free, the only people that we could deal with was our own people.
Yep.
And so then we, you know, progressed from there. Elder Moshe, not for me, Elder Yim.
But go ahead. Two quick points. First, about that's what happened then. But look what's happening in Harlem today.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be all black.
That's right.
And now it has been sold out as we speak.
That's right.
The other point I wanted to make was about what the brother was talking about, the civil rights. You know, when the Civil Rights Act was passed, you know, it was supposed to have given the black man the right to vote. But now they're devising tactics and tricks to keep the black man from voting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because that's what the black man has always put his faith in, is voting for somebody. Mm-hmm. When we look through the scriptures, it's so plain that a fool can't err.
Mm-hmm.
The Most High never said anything about our liberation coming from voting. Never said anything about our liberation coming from getting into politics.
Yeah.
Doing all of that. In fact, we can't even be in politics, shouldn't even be in politics, unless we can vote on our own king.
Mm-hmm.
One from our brethren.
Yeah.
See, but our people are so ignorant, and I hate to use that term, but ignorant just means lack of knowledge. Until we get some knowledge, always going to stay that way. But it's right here in the book, in Yah's book, what he gave us to go by. It's nothing magical about it, it's just called obedience. That's all. Just obedience. But see, we always going off the deep, off the trail. You know, Esau would ask and ask, say, hey, you know, I've joined the NAACP with you guys and kept funding and so forth, just follow us. Now, I might say, hey, humble yourself and start following me. We do what Askenaz said. We do what Martin Luther King said. We do what everybody said to do except for the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
And our people are still doing it. Can't wait until the 2016 election to vote for Miss Ann.
Yeah.
Or Mr. Bill.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody that's going to double and triple the black incarceration rate again.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Elder Yim, then Sister Elam, and then we're going to move on.
Scripture say wisdom is the personal thing. Mm-hmm. Therefore, get ye wisdom, that all you get and get understanding.
Excuse me.
Not only do we not even want wisdom,
mm-hmm.
we don't want it. Because mm-hmm. when somebody tell us something, it's up to us to research it to find out how true that might be.
Right.
We don't even want to go through the hassle, as they might say, to do some research.
Mm-hmm.
Certain things we don't consider, and the Almighty said it best. He said, we're people, we don't know. We don't even consider.
Mm-hmm.
Simple things like in Exodus the third chapter, I'm sorry, the 20th chapter, the third verse, that's the very first commandment. The very first commandment, you don't have no other deity before the Almighty,
mm-hmm.
period.
Mm-hmm.
How can we expect to get ahead if we can't even keep the first commandment? Which one are we going to keep? we can't even keep the very first one. Simple thing, when he said, we don't know, we don't even consider.
Mm-hmm.
Think of this, 12 o'clock, midnight. They'll say, it's another day.
Mm-hmm.
It's right there. Midnight, in the middle of the night. The weekend, all around the world, the first day of the week is what we call Sunday. Now, because people start their work week for the most part on Monday, when they get to the weekend, they include the seventh day, and then they go to the first day. Well, how can the first day be the end of the week?
Right.
It's a simple thing just right there. This book is the most sold, but the least read and the least understood. Because like you said so many times, the only time a person pick up their book is when they go to a church. They might either have their own or pull up off the back of a seat. And then the minister, 9 times out of 10, goes to the New Testament and say, well, let's see what God said.
Mm-hmm.
And then you open up your book and you take a passage completely out of text.
Sure.
And then our people just gobble, just fall for it. Because they have no understanding. Because why? They don't do their own research. They don't do their own reading. And we as a people, we're guilty of that. We won't change, but we don't want to change. We don't want to change as a people. We get all the information. We've been broadcasting for years, even over 1664. If we hear something that might sound like it makes sense, do we research it as a people?
No.
Well, we don't research it. I mean, some may here and there, but as a whole, we don't even do research. We go by opinion. People who don't even go to church or have an opinion about the Bible. You don't even know what's in the book. You don't even know what's in the book, but you have an opinion based on tradition.
Right.
What mom said, what grandma said, what my father was a preacher.
Yeah.
Guess what? My father was a preacher. But we couldn't discuss the book together because I don't know enough. I don't know anything. So that's the mistake our people have in the Almighty said it the best.
Yep.
He know his creation.
He
said, we don't not only do we not know, we as a people don't even consider little simple things.
And what he said, they didn't put us in the law.
An ox?
The ox.
That's right. That's right.
He put us below that.
Mm-hmm.
Because one knows this. Master's crib, and the other one knows his own.
Yeah.
Well, we don't know either one.
Mm-hmm.
And we go along with Brother Young's comment. It reminds me of, I don't know where I heard this from, but somebody said that if all the Christians were to pick up their Bible and stand on their front porch and blow on the cover at the same time, it'd be the biggest dust storm ever. But there's a question on the internet from a new sister. She was asking about Job 1:4, about birthdays. She said she was wondering if we are not to celebrate birthdays, because when it goes, she puts on here, that each one of his sons was celebrating in verse 5 on their day, and she looked up their day in the concordance, H3:1:17, and I guess it says that his day is associated, she says, feasting on the date of their birth. So her question is, you will see, she says you will see that his day can mean birthday, but she wants to know if we are to celebrate birthday.
If we have to celebrate, so I'm getting away from my subject.
It is, so.
But yes, we can celebrate birthday.
Okay. She's a new sister.
Yeah. But there's more important things than birthdays.
Mm-hmm.
See, we have to learn about Yah's law.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you don't know Yah's law, celebrating birthday doesn't mean anything.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. But yes, we can celebrate birthday. Because see, we can't put anything over Yah's law.
That's right.
Anything. As much as we love to do so. Did you have a comment, my sister?
Yes. I want to say our praise to Yahweh.
Hallelujah.
I just want to comment on 20 and really all the comments are Exodus 20, because even in the first verse, Yahweh spoke himself.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have nobody speak for him.
That's right.
He spoke to everyone.
Yes.
And he told everybody what to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to say hallelujah to that. So when the Christian, anybody, whoever, want to say, JC or Elijah Muhammad or whoever, all you gotta just go to Exodus 20.
Mm-hmm.
And there it is right there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. Where are you at?
Yes, sir. I want to comment on two things. The last thing you made regarding the sister,
asking a question about the birthday, and you're absolutely right. Because you ask most of our people, why were they born? Mm-hmm. And they don't even know why they was born. Mm-hmm. But y'all let us know through his great servant, Solomon, the reason why man was born was to serve him and worship him.
That's right.
So it's one thing to celebrate the day that you was born, but do you know why you was born? So we got to get a perspective on all things, and only through the knowledge of Yah we begin to understand all things. And we've been dealing with this, the current events, and what everybody been saying today. I want to comment on that the first commandment. And you notice all on the TV shows and all of the rallies, and when our people come together, I never hear anyone talks about Yah.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
They don't talk about the Most High. It's not even brought into the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
On why things is happening. He's an afterthought. A total afterthought. It's because, the right man is not in office.
Right.
We need to vote some new councilmen in, or we need to get a new president in. Yah never comes up.
Mm-hmm.
And we look at the Christian community or Islamic community. They don't go to their book. They can't go to their book, first of all. And to show the reasons why these things is taking place. But as Yim said, we got to get to the root of the matter, the heart of the matter.
Mm-hmm.
And our people must understand why they are in bondage. We think we're free,
mm-hmm,
here in America.
Mm-hmm.
And our people, I mean, it's enough to make a brass monkey cry. It just breaks you down when we have the answers.
Mm-hmm.
And when you go to them and show them, and they just push you to the side. But it's gonna be through bloodshed.
Mm-hmm.
And what this Most High done used this white man to do, because I already see the handwriting on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to see outbreaks of violence all throughout the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Me and one brother was talking, he think the police officer is going to be indicted. I don't have to be you don't have to be a problem. I assure you, they will not come back with a guilty verdict on any of those police officers. I'll tell you that right now. I tell you that right now, and I already see what's going to happen.
Right.
These cities going to explode.
Mm-hmm.
And when they do, get prepared, as I always stated, lock your doors,
mm-hmm,
stay in your house, because the blood is going to run in the streets.
Yes, it is.
And when y'all talk about tribulation,
mm-hmm,
you can't fathom what's going to take place,
mm-hmm,
on these streets. We, those of us that know y'all,
mm-hmm,
you better have your trust in him.
That's right.
Because if you get caught up out here,
mm-hmm,
I feel for you.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, you don't have to be no prophet to see what's coming.
Right.
And I agree with you. 99%, the only 1% is that I think if they indict anybody, it'd be one of the blacks. They'll be used as a scapegoat, which would be the same results, because the brothers are not going to go for that.
Mm-mm.
And you still got chaos in the
right.
But they think there will be appeasing people,
no.
See,
yeah.
But indicting him.
No.
But as you say, they may not indict any of them.
All
none. Because they don't want to show that,
mm-hmm,
racism or that prejudice,
mm-hmm,
against,
mm-hmm,
one of the brothers, one,
mm-hmm,
of the blacks.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, hey, they know what's coming. So let's just give them more.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just give them more. We're going to move on to, and then I'm going to come back. Because of, and to this sister,
mm-hmm,
you know, they just tuned in.
Mm-hmm.
Don't want to think disinterested in her question and thinking that it's not important. But as Minister Yoel just stated, you know, the Most High's word. And we're in crucial times right now.
Mm-hmm.
And our people have to understand the reason why we're in those crucial these crucial times. It's not just something that came about.
Right.
It is something that is taking place because of our own disobedience to our Creator. And it's just like if you whip a child and he doesn't know the reason why you're whipping him,
right,
then he never corrects his attitude. But once you tell him the reason why, then he has a choice. And if he still doesn't correct his attitude, then he keeps getting whipped.
Yeah.
But at least you give him the opportunity to correct his attitude. Mm-hmm. And most of our people haven't been in light. They either haven't been or they refuse to be. Because this word has been going out now for how long? But from the time that we know what's your name. So at least 40 years. 50 years, actually more. Because Dan and Alicia and Dan were teaching for 40 years. And going out on the internet for at least how long? Maybe 15, 20? So, you know, it's been going out. There's really no excuse for someone not paying attention and trying to correct themselves. So we must show according to the scriptures the reason why. And we're going to go to Second Chronicles 12th chapter. Because a few minutes ago I made a statement that when you transgress against the Most High, then the Most High turns against you. And so, you know, I must show that is correct. It's not just with this incident, but why do you think we went into the Babylonian captivity? Why do you think we came into this captivity and we're up under there? Why do you think the Assyrians? We were this Assyrian captivity. Why do you think we were in any captivity if it wasn't because we transgressed against the Most High and then he let others have a way with us? But see, you're not going to learn that in the church, in any of them, whether it's the Catholic Church, Baptist Church, eating at the bar church, whatever. You're not going to learn that in the church because church is designed to keep you ignorant. Mm-hmm. You know, a man won't teach you who your Creator is. You know he ain't going to teach you anything that your Creator does for you. Mm-hmm. Let's start off at the first verse. And it came, and this is 12th chapter of 2 Chronicles. And it came to pass when Rehoboam had established the kingdom and had strengthened himself. He forsook the law of Yahweh and all Israel with him. Mm-hmm. And that goes following the man again. Mm-hmm. And we're good at that. Following a man, all Israel. If you see any man following the Most High, it's one or two, or three or four. Until the Most High starts smacking us up against our skip head. Then we, hey, for a moment, we get ourselves together and go back and start doing what thus says God. But then, shortly after that, we revert back to our own ways and we start waxing fat. But it says here, he forsook the law of Yahweh and all Israel with him. And it came to pass that in the 50th year of King Rehoboam, Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem because they have what? Transgressed against Yahweh. Who brought the king of Egypt up against Israel? Yeah, he didn't make that move on his own. God stirred him up and brought him up against Israel. And he came with 1,200 chariots and 70,000 horsemen, and the people were without number. that came with him out of Egypt, the Lubans, the Sukums, and the Ethiopians. And he took the 5 cities, which pertained to Yehuda, and came to Jerusalem, or Jerusalem. Then came Shemaiah, the prophet, to Rehoboam and to the prince of Yehuda. They were gathered together to Jerusalem because of Shishak, and said unto them, Thus said Yahweh. And just to stop here for a second, the prophet Shemaiah, there's a book of Shemaiah the prophet that was taken out by our enemies. Okay. So, and it's supposed to be one of the lost books. And I'll try to find out if there's any copies in existence, and I haven't been able to find any yet. You can get copies of Yeshua, you can get Enoch, you can get some of the other apocryphal books, as they call them, but this prophet here, Shemaiah, haven't been able to find it. And the enemies take these books out because of the history about people. See, you destroy people by taking away their language, take away their history, of course, take away their name, take away their culture. These are all ways that you destroy a nation. Because we don't know who you are, we don't know where you came from, you don't know who your Elohim is, and hey, you don't know much of anything. Whereupon the princes of Israel and the king humbled themselves, and they said, Yahweh is righteous. Well, they said humble or fast? They said humble.
Yes, that's humble.
I thought that's what they said. My glasses sort of steaming up. Had to make sure. Humble yourself. And that's what we have to do now. In captivity, is humble ourselves to the Most High. You want these police officers to stop killing our folks? Then we as a nation have to start humbling ourselves. And how do we humble ourselves? Start doing the law. Start going to the whorehouse on the first day. Give up that pork and all the unclean food. Start keeping every law that you see in these scriptures. Reads number 6 again. Whereupon the princes of Israel and the king humbled themselves, and they said, Yahweh is righteous. And when Yahweh saw that they humbled themselves, the word of Yahweh came to Shemaiah, saying, They have humbled themselves, therefore I will not destroy them, but I will grant them some deliverance, and my wrath shall not be poured out upon Jerusalem by the hand of Shishak. And that's what the Most High used Martin Luther King for and so forth, was to bring some little relief. But the basic captivity, he couldn't get rid of that. He could make the world sympathize with the little children being blown up in the churches and grown men being hung. Up to a certain time period, because after it was still going on in some parts of the South. You know, grown men be chased by a gang of white men and take it and attach a rope to an oak tree or something and hang them by the neck until they die. All this stuff went on through the 60s. So they just bought a little relief. Yeah, you can eat with Miss Ann there. They're not saying anything to her.
No.
Because they're going to take you out there and beat you to death. You're going to look like Emmett Till.
Yeah.
Won't even recognize you. But for CI people, that was a little relief. Because like you said earlier, hey, you know, white man's ice is cold. His water is cold. His food tastes better. We're just sick people. And when Yahweh saw they humbled themselves, the word of Yahweh came to Shemaiah saying, They have humbled themselves, therefore I will not destroy them, but I will grant them some deliverance, and my wrath shall not be poured out upon Jerusalem by the hand of Shishak. Nevertheless, they shall be his servants, that they may know my service and the service of the kingdoms of the country. So Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem and took away the treasures of the house of Yah and the treasures of the king's house. He took all. He carried away also the shields of gold which Solomon had made, instead of which King Rehoboam made shields of brass. It's a long way from gold to brass. And the chief of the grant of the guard that kept the entrance of the king's house. And when the king entered into the house of Yah, the guard came and fetched them and brought them again into the guard chamber. And when he humbled himself, the wrath of Yahweh turned from him, that he would not destroy him altogether, and also in Yehuda things went well. Now just think, if we just humble ourselves, how much better Israel could be. And this wasn't all the tribes of Israel. This wasn't the whole nation of Israel. This was those that followed Jehovah, which I think he had, what, two tribes? Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 1. Read from the first verse to the 19th verse. And this is Jeremiah. And again, all we're doing is seeing in these verses that we're reading how we transgress against the Most High and the punishment that the Most High brought against us. We're doing that. Because we are in a state of disobedience every day. Every day we're in a state of disobedience. Our nation is. Our nation, not as individuals. Some of them may be as individuals too. But our nation as a whole is in a state of disobedience every day.
Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 1. The words of Jeremiah the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were in Anathoth, in the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of Yahweh came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Yehuda, in the 13th year of his reign. It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Yehuda, unto the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Yehuda, unto the carrying away of Jerusalem, captive in the 5th month. Then the word of Yah came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee.
So what is this telling us? That Yah knows his servants before his servants even know.
Hallelujah.
Right there, he knew Jeremiah in the womb. He created Jeremiah for the purpose of going forth and prophesying to the world about Yah and his ways. See, sometimes we don't even take that in consideration. You know, and that's why, you know, he said, He left instructions for us not to do his prophets any harm. And we are not to lay a hand on Yah's ministers or prophets at all. To remove them, but to do anything of that nature to them. Because if Yah anoints someone to be his servant, and they're not cutting the mustard, as old elders used to say, hey, Yah will remove them. But when you start talking about, we're going to set him down, and we're going to remove him, and we're going to do this and that, you're looking for some serious, serious retribution from the Most High. When I say that, because sometimes people think that they're so high that they can do that. Yeah. And especially when somebody has been serving the Most High before they was even born. And they're walking with the Most High before they even born. If the Most High ever removed them, you keep yourself away from them. Don't talk about doing this and doing that. And try to conspire with others to do it. Yes, sir.
Verse 5. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, Yahweh Elohim, behold, I cannot speak. For I am a child. But Yahweh said unto me, say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak.
Yes, sir. Does it look like Jeremiah enjoyed Yahweh choosing him to be a servant, choosing him to be a prophet? No, he didn't. He didn't at all. But the Most High said that he chose him. He knew him when he was in his mother's belly. He knew him as a child. And that he anointed him to do this great work. And in order to do this great work, he had to have certain, there were certain things that he had to abide by, which we're going to find out in just a few seconds. Yes, sir.
Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith Yah.
Okay. Why do we think Yah told him not to be afraid of the faces? What does that mean? Yes, sir, Brother Michael.
Yeah, it's going to seem like you're alone, but I'm always going to be there with you. It's going to seem like you're outnumbered. It's going to seem like it's going to get, they're going to try to persecute you. They're going to try to talk down on you. They're going to try to come at you all the type of way. Mm-hmm. Just I'm going to put words in your mouth and tell you how to speak. And speak boldly. Speak on behalf of me and know that I got you. You got to have faith that I'm going to protect you.
That's right.
And if you have the faith, you'll speak as you will. Mm-hmm. You won't speak as a timid man. You won't speak. You won't hold nothing back. You know what I'm saying? On your mind. You won't be quote unquote censored. Some people try to censor people.
That's right. And that's very important for y'all's ministers. You know, have to be bold when they speak. And I talk about bold to the point that they're, what's the term I want to use right now?
Disrespectful.
There's another term to it, though. Obnoxious or whatever. You know, you speak with the conviction, of the Most High. If he says this is the way it should be, or whatever the message is to give to the people, give it to them. Don't be afraid of what they're going to say or what they're going to think about you. And a lot of times we're afraid of even offending our friends. Because you can offend somebody with the truth. And when you're speaking the Most High's word, that is the truth. And someone that's not ready to hear that, you're going to offend them. But you can't say, well, I hate to say this, you know, because my buddy, you know, we played ball, we graduated from school together, we were best buddy. But, you know, what I'm getting ready to say is gonna hurt. And I just, you know, just dance around that. I come back to it a little bit later. No, God, you can't do that. Yes, Sister.
I was just gonna add to that comment. When you're afraid of their faces, because they're not going to look at you the same way. And you may be afraid to lose that, their countenance towards you.
Right, and you know, when you start teaching the Almighty's Word, you're going to lose some friends that you thought was friends. You know, just stopping the doing what you was doing with them on the Shabbat day. You'll find out that they're going to alienate you. They're not going to be there anymore because you can't do what they want you to do. Mm-hmm. And they don't respect that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've been going out with this in every, we've been doing this every Saturday. Nate's talking about, that's the Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. And every day's a Sabbath day. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can't be afraid of that. You might walk alone, but you never walk alone when you walk with the Most High.
Go ahead. Verse 9. Then Yahweh put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And Yahweh said unto me, Behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pour down and to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. Moreover, the word of Yah came unto me, saying, Jeremiah, what seest thou? And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then said Yahweh unto me, Thou hast well seen, for I will hasten my word to perform it. And the word of Yah came unto me the second time, saying, What seest thou? And I said, I see a seeding pot, and the face thereof is toward the north. Then Yah said unto me, Out of the north an evil shall break forth upon all the inhabitants of the land. Okay.
You see that? Now why? Well, why was he bringing all of this evil from the north upon the people of the land? As we read on, we'll see, because of their wickedness. The Almighty lets us go, and He lets us go, and He lets us go. And we haven't corrected ourselves, we haven't attached ourselves to His law and so forth, then He brings on destruction. But see, we fail to realize that. And it's right there. It's right there, and I hope anyone on the internet who is hearing this for the very first time is looking and go. And we're not going to go through the whole book of Jeremiah, but just continue to read. That's why we have Jacob's trouble, because we disobeyed. Still, after being placed here in this country, they say for 400 years. 400 years is not up, but during that time of 400 years while we're here, our people are going to catch hell. Some serious hell. This right here that you're seeing with the police all over the country slaying our people, these are still good days. Mm-hmm. Still good days. But can you imagine what to say, Yoel? The days of Jacob's trouble, alas, that day is great. A day like no other. Mm-hmm. You put slavery, which was nothing compared to the seed. Mm-hmm. You put all of the captivities together. And this day of Jacob's trouble is like none of those. You know what we're in for, brother?
Yeah.
You know. But you know what? Some of our people still refuse. And all we're doing right now is just showing you that, hey, when you transgress against the Most High, He's going to send some retribution to you. Yes, sir.
Verse 15. For lo, I will call all the families of the kingdoms of the north, saith Yah, and they shall come, and they shall set everyone his throne at the entering of the gates of Jerusalem, and against all the walls thereof round about, and against all the cities of Judah. And I will utter my judgments against them, touching all their wickedness, who have forsaken me, and have burned incense unto other deities, and worshipped the works of their hands.
Yes, sir. So anybody who's serving JC, mm-hmm. Uncle Al, Uncle Bud, or any other deity, even though you're not burning incense to them, you're still bowing your knees down, you're still giving them your what?
Praise.
Your praise. You're still praying to this thing that couldn't even help himself.
Right.
He's still reverenced above all things. Mm-hmm. To you.
Allah.
Well, you see what? Yes, right. Uncle Al, he's not eliminated.
Mm-hmm.
But you see what the Most High said. He's visiting you in iniquities, your wickedness.
Mm-hmm.
Man. And believe me, some pride and some wishing they had did something different, wish they had an opportunity to go back and change things. But sometimes your wishing is just a wish, especially when you have all the time in the world. All the time in the world, I was telling Yoel and Yael, when he's reading through the book of Yeshua, that when he got in the sixth chapter, when he dealt with Noah,
mm-hmm.
building the ark,
that's right.
The Almighty told him, say, I'm going to give these people 120 years to get their act together. 120 years. And that, you know, when the Almighty was getting ready to release everything upon the people, and lock the doors on the ark, mm-hmm. just Noah and his family, mm-hmm. and the animals that he was commanded to take in, they still hadn't got this stuff together.
Mm-hmm.
And try to break in mm-hmm. to the ark, because he refused to let him in. But the animals that he couldn't take on, they slew him. But to show you how people are, the Almighty gave you a certain length of time. We got 400 years.
Yeah.
Not as individuals, but as a nation, mm-hmm. to get our stuff together. Mm-hmm. And we still haven't done it.
Right.
So if the days of Jacob's trouble started tomorrow, we'd be in a heck of a shape.
That's right.
A heck of a shape.
That's right.
Because our people as a whole were not ready.
No.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Verse 17, now therefore gird up thy loins, and arise, and speak unto them all that I command thee. Be not dismayed at their faces, lest I confound thee before them. For behold, I have made thee this day a defense city, and an iron pillar, and brazen walls against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, against the princes thereof, against the priests thereof, and against the people of the land. And they shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. For I am with thee, saith Yah, to deliver thee.
Hallelujah. See, we can't fight against the Most High's message. You know, we can try to do everything in the world to obstruct them, but we can't fight against them. Because if the Most High is with them, hey, who could be against you? And that's one thing our people have to realize too. Yeah. We can fight against those little Jack Lane ministers and everybody else out there, but you're not going to fight against the Most High Yah. Okay, let's let's look at Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy 32. start at verse 16.
Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 16. They provoked him to jealousy with strange deities. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto devils, not to Elohim, to deities whom they knew not, to new deities that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. O the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful, and have forgotten Elohim that formed thee. And when Yahweh saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be. For they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not Elohim. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities. And I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation.
Hallelujah. Does that let us know what we're dealing with? First, because our people substituted our fountains of living water for an idol. For an idol. An idol. Not just one, but we, for what? Levels of many deities. In fact, when you go through the scriptures, you can see why we adopted the gods of many nations. Gods of many nations. And you can see where he says, I will hide my face from them, from our people, and you wonder why you're not getting any relief? Because Almighty is not listening to you. He's not responding to you because of your wickedness. Idolatry. We are idolatry makers. And I say that because we as a nation don't even educate our children to serve in Yah. And so they grow to be idolaters. So you take a family of five, and if we're multiplying like they say we do, within 15 years, 20 years, we've got 6, 7 children that are coming up worshiping idols just like their parents did. And so you're out there worshiping these false idols, JC, Uncle Al, the two most popular ones, and then you got some in the Hindu religion, you got some in the Buddhist religion, you got some in every little thing that's out there that our people are still following. And all of these things that is followed, that you're following, are idols. And your children are following them as well. Because what is it in Psalms, I think it's 96, where it says all the nations, all the gods of the nations, are what?
Idols.
Idols. If I heard something like that and I wasn't already serving Yah, that made me want to check, what is this? What is this? When somebody's telling me that my God is no God, it's an idol. What is this? I want some information. We just keep clinging on to it. So when brother gets shot, and if brother gets shot tonight, even in our own community, hey, and Yahweh's not putting a stop to it, You wonder why? Because you're not serving him. You're serving yourself. Tomorrow these whorehouses will be so full, mm-hmm. you won't be able to park in any lot from here to Lincoln Heights. And Lincoln Heights has a whorehouse on every corner. And all of them are full. Mm-hmm. In fact, they got more churches than they got residents. Mm-hmm. My brother Jim, he knows what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. They have more whorehouses than they have residents. Mm-hmm. Just imagine. If we had that many Knessets and all of them were full on the Shabbat day, man, what kind of blessing would that be? But on the Shabbat day, before we even get together, you get up early, 6-7 o'clock in the morning. Hey, drive by either one of them and you see cars out there lining up. We talking about brothers coming here on the Shabbat day at 1 o'clock and can't even get here at 1 o'clock some of them. It's like Israel treat the Most High. But serving the idol, hey, 6-7 o'clock in the morning, that's what time the pastor say, we're gonna have a twilight or whatever they call it, a morning service. No, I'm gonna be there. I mean, we're some heck of a people. Some heck of a people. Yes, sir.
I want to comment on these verses so deep. Yeah. This 16 through 20. And it takes me back to Isaiah, the 42nd chapter, the 8th verse, where he said, I am Yahweh, that is my name. Mm-hmm. And my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Mm-hmm. I like to ask all the men that's in this room, and by way of the internet, if your wife came home and you see her shirt, another man's name written on there, How would that make you feel?
Get some problems.
There's going to be some problems, huh? Yeah, you're right. Mm-hmm. And our people don't understand. Most are jealous.
That's right.
And we have that attribute as well, men and women, because it goes for a woman as well. If her husband come in, he got these different women names on him. Who's that baby? Well, that's my ex. And y'all is no different. He's a jealous Elohim. Mm-hmm. And you ask our people, what's the creator's name? Well, you know his name is, if they don't say the Lord and God with this title, his name is Jesus. Mm-hmm. Or his name is Christ. Mm-hmm. They don't know the Father's name. Mm-hmm. Right. So you ask them, what's the name of the quarterback on the football team in the city you in at? They can the receiver. when it comes to the Most High, they say, "Oh, he got me name. He don't matter what you call him. He's not a mini old thing." And Most High said, "No, I have a name, and my name is Yah. And my glory I've done given to these graven images, especially on hippie on a stick. And as I said right here, new God that came newly up, and that was." As my brother was saying earlier, Jesus, they don't even want to consider do research on that name.
Right.
That is the name of a Greek idol, Zeus.
That's right.
They took the Z out, put a J, and added a F. These are new deities.
Yep.
And as with Islam as well. Mm-hmm. They know, and our people don't know Yah at all. Ask the Muslims, what's his name? Allah.
Yep.
But that's not a name.
Yep. Uh-huh.
All that means is the God. So they don't even know.
Right. Uh-huh. And, you know, all these idols, especially, we just want to deal with the Christian idols. There has always been an idol that JC was founded off of in the world centuries ago, long before there was any JC.
Right.
Long before that. So our people just attach themselves to anything and everything that they possibly can, except for the Most High. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir, Brother Mike.
Oh, yeah. Our people are impatient, and they're not good. Y'all's presence is not good enough. They want his position.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, what wood and stone is tangible. I I can see it, I can put my hands on it. Mm-hmm. So the Father, they feel like they can't see him, so therefore they can't praise him because they can't put their hands on him. Like the money, the cars, and the jewelry, and everything that they love, it's tangible. They can see it, they can put their hands on it. Mm-hmm. So man's ideology is basically based upon tangible things, things I can touch. Mm-hmm. So I can't touch him, so the wooden stone is what I'm praying. And it was an old story by Ashanti was given that Abraham crushed him with that. They call him the idol crusher. Mm-hmm. He crushed him with a sledgehammer. And the dad was like, what you doing? He was like, Terah was like, what you doing? He was like, he said, what are you doing? You killing the idols? He said, tell him, just tell him. He said, tell him to stop me. He said, he can't. He said, then why you worshiping them?
Yeah.
Why you worship things that have no power and no sight? And also want to touch on this here. This was powerful because in 21 it says, I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people.
Mm-hmm.
And I will provoke them to anger with the foolish nation.
Mm-hmm.
The Edomites, which are not a people. Mm-hmm. And the foolish nation is us as a people. Right. The ones that don't know Yah. And we are jealous of our own people. We had our own skin, we had our own color. And mm-hmm. that's the wilderness syndrome. And going back to the tall versus short, the dark versus light.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of us being women, I don't mess with that dark. It's just a lot of foolishness all throughout. Mm-hmm. And we hate each other for all different number reasons. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He didn't speak 10 years ago when he came. That's the same. He came to the barbecue and he didn't speak. It's so much foolishness. And he said, I turned that jealousy against y'all, and we are the most hateful people of our own. We would kill everybody else, we'd talk about all people.
Sure will.
But we get right when she the overseer, the master. We don't got no comment on them, won't say nothing about them, won't disrespect them. People, you know, like you hear people on the phone, and like I know people that cuss all day, then they get around the other people, the Edomites, and they like, I'm around them, so don't be cussing when you're around them. So they act a certain type of way for a foolish nation, a people that are not a people.
That's right.
Or a beast. He's never been a man. He's a beast.
That's right.
So when you look at that, you gotta really dissect that and understand that they're not a people. Never will be a people. They are a beast that have been set as a catalyst to put a yoke around your neck, to put you in bondage because Yah said so.
That's
not
right.
Because they were strong enough, because we were given into their hands.
And if you analyze it like you said, you can see they are like any other two-legged man.
Right.
On the face of the earth, you don't, and four-legged beasts as well,
that's right.
Because they are the only nation that will go from one end of the earth slaying, slaughtering of people for their own purpose. When a lion or a cheetah or something like that in the jungle, when he's wild, when he eats or kills to eat, it's for that eat. When he's not hungry, he doesn't kill.
Mm-hmm.
But this man has went from one end of the earth to the other end of the earth to fulfill his purpose of domination.
Mm-hmm.
And he has killed, he has slaughtered, he has maimed, he has no respect for the elders, none for the young, male or female. So he has a personality of a beast that's different from the beast that was born a beast.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Okay.
I just want to make a comment. One day last week, well, my grandson, he does the rapping, Zuriel, he's 8 years old. He made a comment. He always come home and talk to me about what's going on in school. And he said, Granny, you know what? I'm like, what is it, Zuri? Because he acts like he's about 18, he's very intelligent. He said, I just got to get away from that school. I said, now what's going on? You know, I don't like school anyway, but now what's going on? He goes, those children, they don't know y'all. All they talk about is JC, and I'm just tired of it. I want to go to a different school. I say, well, Zuri, I'm sorry, sweetie. They don't know y'all. And if you go to a different school, those children not gonna know y'all.
Right.
And the only thing we can do is we have to have our own Hebrew school where all the Israelites are together that do know y'all. But other than that, wherever you go, if you go into these schools, all these children, the majority of them, that's all they know is JC. And so it's just ironic that, you know, he picked up that, you know, he tried to talk to those kids, talk to them about Christmas, he talked to him about Santa Claus, He talked to him about drinking milk. He talked to him about lies, you know. So he gets himself in a lot of trouble in school, and it's really hard. So, you know, this our praises that Almighty that, you know, he do know y'all, and it's just that he's trying to talk to the children in his class.
Yeah.
Sister
Don.
Hallelujah. I was thinking about something that Maria Wells said. How there are people who just say you can call the Most High any name, mm-hmm. and it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. If somebody calls you by any name, you would be offended by that. Yep. If somebody mispronounces your name, you would quickly correct them. Mm-hmm. So why is it that one would think the creator of everything, you can just address him any type of way you feel and he's going to respond? Right. That doesn't make sense.
Nope. It does. And we one of the people that don't make sense.
Mm-hmm.
You don't?
Mm-hmm.
Because anyone that I just can't imagine. I can't imagine seeing all the glories of the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking about from back there when the Exodus was in the back. You know, because our people, after all of that, still turned their back on the Most High. As soon as Moses was out of sight, they go back to their idolatry. As soon, it's just like you stepping out your door to go to the store, you come back, and then, you know, your wife got some big old dude standing out there, you know. Hey. That's great.
You were speaking earlier about how we would have generations where the parents didn't teach the children anything, mm-hmm. right? And when we look around, we can see clearly that the Almighty God's word is so true. He said it was going to provoke us to jealousy with a nation that was not a people, a foolish people. We have young people, young Israelites who don't know who they are,
mm-hmm.
all over the country, that we call a lost generation, that are the most disrespectful people that you can come across. You get your own people who treat you worse than the beast.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember being called a nigger or this, that, and the other until I started working around a lot of young folks.
Mm-hmm.
Because old folks don't address you like that. Intelligent ones anyway. I can recall that in the last few years, not even the last few years, but in the last couple of years especially, being called names I ain't never been called before by my people. A foolish people, but you know where they get it from. They see their little white counterparts, if you want to call them a counterpart, doing certain things. And so they want to do it because now, with young folks, if you want to be cool, you got to do what's wrong. Because they take the things that are wrong and justify them as being right.
Mm-hmm.
And the things that are right, they always justify as being wrong.
Mm-hmm.
No more. No more father at all. And it's so sad. It really is. I don't know about y'all, but sometimes my eyes just glaze over because I'm in bad form. Because they don't know to be in bad because it's their norm. I see young people talking to their parents in the most disrespectful way. I'm talking about black children. Cussing them all just totally disrespectful. Why? Because they weren't taught. They got away with everything. No morals instilled them. You would think that they picked it up from white folks, but they didn't.
No.
They didn't.
No.
They picked it up from just being loose. Parents not attending to them.
Mm-hmm.
Allowing them. And the scripture said a child left to himself is a shame to his mother.
Mm-hmm.
It's a shame to the whole community. Because once they get of a certain age, you really can't talk to them. If they don't want to be turned around, they're not going to be turned around. And why one of the reasons, and I have to say this, and I'm going to cut it short. A lot of times, I blame the fathers, and I'll tell you why. Because for whatever reason, in most cases, the father is not at home. Whether he's dead, incarcerated, chased out by the mother, or just said, hey, responsibility, I gotta go. For whatever reason. So that's what you call a dysfunctional household. Because the order which the Almighty said is not there. Mm-hmm. And like you said, bless all the single parent household, whether it's the mother, the grandmother, the aunt, or uncle, whoever take care of the child. But when you don't have a father there, a strong, and I ain't talking about muscle bound strong, when you don't have a strong minded male there who's keeping the Almighty's law, what are you going to come up with? Mm-hmm. What are you bringing? We're going to be bringing up a holy seed.
But you know, that's not and that was prophesied, you know, by the Most High. Mm-hmm. He said, you know, our children or babes will rule over the household, and that women will suppress a man. Mm-hmm. You know, what they call it, a new thing in the earth, yeah. Where the woman will surpass a man. Mm-hmm. And if you look around, whose household is affected by that? You know, if a woman and a man is working in the household, who makes the money in there? The women. The women. And could be doing the same job.
That's how you know this book is living.
That's right. Because that was written thousands of years ago. And it applies to today, right to the teeth. That's why I can't understand why our people don't understand. And it has to be because the majority of them is not reading. Mm-hmm. It's mind-boggling. Mm-hmm. It's mind-boggling. You can look at that and know what is going to happen from day to day, mm-hmm. or year to year. Mm-hmm. Because it's in the book. Mm-hmm. It may come in a form that you don't understand, and you can't get that understanding until you really get into it.
like Sister Dawn was saying, GLD is just a title. Mm-hmm. That's like going to a hospital, a major hospital, and say, I want to talk to the doctor. They're going to say, what doctor? Which one? Right. You go to a law firm. Right. I want to talk to the lawyer. Right. Which lawyer? In Psalm 68, 4, it says, sing unto you. Mm-hmm. It didn't say sing unto JC,
right.
or the Muslim, mm-hmm. deity. Our people won't do it. It's right there. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying, I have never heard a gospel song with Yah in it.
That's right.
And probably never will.
Until they say hallelujah?
Then they don't know what that means.
Lord Mike?
Praise Yah.
Hallelujah.
I did hear one gospel group that was singing a song, and it was called All Praises to Yahweh. Mm-hmm. And it was singing praise to Yahweh, but guess what? It was an all white gospel that was singing. And when it dealing with the children, that's a great thing is working with our youth. And I say that because I was blessed to teach the youth class for a number of years. And I realized something. I used to do homework packets, or not a homework packet, but I would give it would be a syllabus of what we're gonna learn and what we're gonna do and then the homework. And I would hand it out to all the parents, and then I happened to see that most of the parents would take it, mm-hmm. rip off to write down their phone number, they're going to give it somebody else with it.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. And then we yell at their children. I remember one instance where I had taught a class on fringes to my youth class. And I got on some of my youth because I said, y'all born into this. Mm-hmm. Y'all got family members that make fringes. I'll buy them. Mm-hmm. Where are yours? Parents, loving my kid, you being kind of, can you stop? Can you this? And my mindset at that point was, no, I can't. because I have to teach. But with our youth, the adults, we live in a society now where, as LDM said, where we call evil
good.
So when you see a youth, and this is to our young people that are listening or that are in this room, when you walking with the Most High, you're going to be shunned. And it's not always by your own age group, it's adults. Somebody will say, what you mean you're going to go have sex till you get married? Boy, what's wrong with you? Is you gay? Is you this? Is it that? But no, but when you want to do the right thing, if the we have a generation of adults that, like you said, they don't read. They don't read. Everything is, if you don't put it on a video, if it's not on your, if you can't download it on your cell phone, we ain't picking it up.
Yeah, that's right.
We ain't picking it up. And our youth are hurt, number one, because we are hurt in the sense of where the household, the order of the household is broken. Where now when you, most men now, and I'm not being sexist, but I'm just keeping it 100 because the Almighty told the man to rule over the household. Now, it's the woman that rules the household. Now, the man he can't do nothing in the household without the wife's permission. Even though he work and bring home money, and now that the woman works and bring home money, she feels, I got equal say-so. I had a conversation with some sisters and I almost got my head chopped off. We were watching Lion King with the youth. And I said, no, we watched a documentary of all lions. And I said, that's perfect order. Mm-hmm. You see that? Where the lions go out and they hunt and they bring it back to the pride. The male eats. And then the others eat in this one particular. No, that ain't how it should be. It should be this way. That's perfect order. Why? Because to us it looks like the male, all he does is lay up and take the prey. But the male is in charge of protecting that prey. He's the one that goes out. He's the one that pushes the young son out. See, that's what we've lost. See, the entities that we were supposed to have dominion over actually are having more sense than we do. When you look at the animal kingdom, you don't see no male animal laying up with his mama. He's 30 years old in the basement. There was a story where, and I mean to say that not if you, because you know circumstances can happen. But I mean, if you able-bodied and willing, there was a story where a woman and her son was in McDonald's. And the woman and the son were kicked out of this McDonald's because she was breastfeeding her son. The woman was in her 70s, her son is in his 40s.
No. What?
She said, this is my baby. No, that's a grown man. He left being a baby a long time ago. But we look and we'll go all that so far-fetched, but that's what we're doing to our youth, especially to our young boys. You see, that whole dynamic should be that father and then that mother. But where the ideal home should be Yahweh, that father, and then that mother. That's how that home dynamic should be. But thanks to Christianity, it's them loosened the bands of common sense. Because Christianity says, it'll tell you. See, they don't read that part of the Bible where it says a woman's not even supposed to speak. Because you got female evangelists.
Right.
It don't mention that part. What it does is, and then you got these men who the New Testament, it softens you. It takes the warrior out of you. That's why when these churches pop up and they got rainbows and first man and this, that, and them, and the pastor and the husband, it's no surprise because the New Testament lets that happen. It says it's okay. It takes the warrior mentality out of you and it tells you to look at your master as though he is Christ.
Right.
Yeah. So when you're indoctrinated with that, and you indoctrinated that, and you go from generation to generation to generation, you're going to have a generation of those to what we have today, to where we have youth that are going to be disrespectful because they're not taught how to be respectful. You understand? I seen, it used to be a time when I was coming up where if an elder came down the street, no matter how rowdy me and my crew was, we moved out the way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now the elders move out the way.
Yeah.
They scoop, they walk in the street to avoid them. But that's the life we chose when we didn't want to have Yahweh as our king. Now this is the key example of how other nations lived. That's why Yahweh didn't want to deal with other nations. That's why he said, I'm destroying other nations. We want to be just like the nations. Mm-hmm. Yahweh said, I'm destroying.
That's right. Mm-hmm. We want to have a king just like the other nations, and we want to adopt their ways. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what we've done. That's what I say. We asked for this oppression, but we got it. So whatever we get, you know, this man is going overboard, but hey, whatever we get, that's what was in store for us who refused the Most High. Sister Hila, then we're going
to
move on.
Okay, I just wanted to comment on verse 21, where it says that Yahweh provoked us to jealousy with a nation that's not even a people,
mm-hmm.
and that is so true. Because you can just look at the way that this foolish nation lives so lavishly. Mm-hmm. They have every luxury available to them,
mm-hmm.
and we are so jealous of that to the point that we have pursued every vanity there is, and we have excelled and become number one in these vanities.
Mm-hmm.
There is not, if there's a black person in any sport, or whatever it is, we are always number one in that. And you know, it even to the point of worshiping Christ. You know, we see this foolish nation worshiping Christ, and we, you know, we excel in that. So you know, it's true what the Most High said. When He moved us to this jealousy, it has been our detriment because we cannot turn back to Him. Because we are inflamed in this jealousy.
Mm.
And, you know, for us to continue to ignore, you know, that this is the hand of the Most High dealing with our people, you know, I don't understand, you know, what it boggles me. Why we can't, you know, we don't see it. No matter, I don't know if we've been hit too much or not hit enough, but we just can't come back.
We actually see, right. You know, the type of people the Most High dealt with them since He created them. It's not a very good sight. But now I'm gonna ask some questions again. And these questions are very simple. But as usual, it deals with not just what we know, but what we believe. Because sometimes what we believe is not what we know. See? And what we know is not what we believe, or the way that we believe to be so. But these are very simple. And I'm going to start off by reading Leviticus 19. 17 verse. Leviticus 19, 17 verse.
Leviticus chapter 19, verse 17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thy